Good afternoon, and welcome to the We Bounce Forward Digital Forum, brought to you by fintechalliance.ph, in collaboration with Kashalo Orient Express, Signal, CIMB Bank, FIS, GCash, Institute of Corporate Directors, Ignite, Institute for Solidarity in Asia, Management Association of the Philippines, Multisys, Next Bank Software, Novus Technologies, PayMaya, PLDT Enterprise, Rural Bankers Association of the Philippines, RCBC, Smart, and One News. This is the We Bounce Forward Digital Forum on Pump Priming a Digital Economy Post-COVID-19. We are waiting for our other participants to log in. Our digital forum will begin in a few minutes.
What makes a good life? Choices. Why put up with this when you can do this? Why settle when you know you deserve even more? Why choose to live in the past when you have a choice to go forward? Make a choice today. Forward to the life you want.
Is easy.
Buckle up right now. There's no need to hide. Get out and come with me. Blast off, what a feeling.
Pag ganito kadali mag-shop, send, save. What can't you do? GCash.
Ang staysafe.ph ay isang community-driven contact tracing, health condition reporting, at social distancing system. Kung ikaw ay app user, manonotify ka rin sa mga lugar na may positive, probable, or suspected COVID-19 cases. Sa pamamagitan nito, makakaiwas ka at ang iyong pamilya sa pagpunta sa mga lugar na ito. O di kaya'y paalalahanan sila na maging mas maingat. Ang iyong data ay ma-upload sa isang secure database na ma-access ng ating gobyerno, lokal na pamahalaan at frontliners upang matulungan ng mga registrant na maaaring COVID-19 positive at pag-contact trace sa kanilang mga nakasalamuha. Kailangan natin ang tulong ng bawat isa. Kaya nating mapigilan ang pagkalat pa ng COVID-19 basta tayo ay sama-sama. Kaya tara na! Digital bayanihan gamit ang staysafe.ph. Stay at home, stay healthy, stay safe.
tomorrow calling. I go where you go. 'Cause we belong to something. We belong to something new. In the midst of a midnight hour, you said to me, we are a different kind.
Mas pinadali at pinabilis na ang pag-accept ng payments para sa iyong online business with PayMaya Negosyo. Sa PayMaya Negosyo app, pwede kang tumanggap ng safe and contactless payments mula sa iyong customers anytime, anywhere. Via QR code, send money transfers, or bank transfers. Mobile number mo lang, pwede ka na nilang bayaran. Madali lang ang pag-sign up. I-download lang sa Google Play Store and register for free. Be a PayMaya Negosyo merchant in just 2 days with no monthly fees. Learn more about PayMaya Negosyo. I-visit ang www.paymaya.com/negosyo-merchant today.
Our aim has always been to make a positive impact on every single business.
Life, as we know it, will never be the same again. And times like these remind us of the core of what we do, to be at the heart of things that matter.
In response to one unprecedented challenge, we invested in the most extraordinary resource of all, our people.
As long as our frontliners are out there, our first responders will be in here.
While our unsung heroes work to make sure that the society continues to run, our brave employees will make sure that their systems are up and running.
In their endeavor to keep the nation safe, we commit to keeping their data and the whole ICT ecosystem secure.
Together, we are one with the nation, for the nation.
Did you know you can manage your account, pay your bills, and transfer funds anytime, anywhere with RCBC online banking? Signing up is easy. You don't even have to go to a branch or an ATM. Here's how. Download the RCBC online banking app from the App Store, Google Play Store, or Huawei App Gallery. Tap the register button found on the login screen. Now you can start transacting with us anytime, anywhere through the RCBC online banking app.
When uncertainty is our reality, we rise above with the things that matter. Gigify happiness. Gigify love. Gigify friendship. Gigify dreams. Gigify hope. With Smart Giga Music, video, games, work, and stories, we let our passions run free in the new world we face together. Smart Live Giga.
Good afternoon. This is We Bounce Forward, a digital forum brought to you by fintechalliance.ph. Please welcome your moderator this afternoon, the Chiefs and the big story anchor at One News on Signal TV, and the founder and CEO of Puma Podcast, Mr. Robbie Alampay.
Good afternoon and welcome to We Bounce Forward, a digital forum brought to you by the FinTech Alliance. Our topic is Pump Priming a Digital Economy Post-COVID-19. We are simulcast on Facebook Live at the fintechalliance.ph Facebook account in various watch parties hosted by key industry partners and also on Signal TV's One News. Before we begin, let's all have a moment of silence and join the FinTech Alliance Trustee and Chair of Techno Ethics Committee, Ms. Ida Tiong Son, in prayer.
Thank Thank you, Ravi. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, in this time of uncertainty, we turn to you and we ask for your protection and guidance. We pray that you keep our frontliners safe, also our health workers fighting for their lives, of those afflicted with COVID-19, and our essential workers ensuring that our society continues to operate as normal as possible. We pray for clarity of mind and steady leadership. Fill us with strength and courage. Grant us wisdom and grace so that we may find a way through our doubts and help our countrymen recover in this crisis. This we ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Now, please join us for the Philippine National Anthem. Once again, welcome to everyone tuned in virtually to We Bounce Forward. This is a digital forum organized by fintechalliance.ph. We hope everyone, of course, is safe, healthy, and well, and we trust everybody's finding ways to adjust and thrive in the new normal that we are all living in. It's just been a few days since Metro Manila shifted to the modified ECQ. As we all know, the MECQ has restarted parts of the economy with a limited number of workers in essential industries allowed to return to work. In a few weeks, if all goes well, we will shift to the general community quarantine, which would hopefully loosen more of the restrictions that were put in place to protect the Filipino population from COVID-19. As the country and the rest of the world have had to shut down to flatten the curve, we increasingly went online, holding virtual meetings, shopping at online merchants and retailers, even working out in front of our computer monitors and tablet screens. A world where social distancing is becoming the norm, taking most, if not all, of our interactions on a digital level seems the most prudent way of doing things. This afternoon, we will be tackling the challenges and solutions offered by a digital economy in our digital forum. Now, before we do that, let's all be officially welcomed by the chairman of the fintechalliance.ph and executive vice president and chief innovation and inclusion officer of RCBC, Mr. Lito Villanueva.
Thank you, Robbie. So welcome to the We Bounce Forward Digital Forum of the fintechalliance.ph. So this week, some businesses have been allowed to reopen. It's the start of our long and hard road to economic recovery. What lies ahead of our country is still unclear, though. Too many variables are at play and beyond our control. But with the opportunity to rebuild our nation and shape a new and better normal, our best chances is through strong and collective effort. So thank you for joining us today. This digital forum is shaping up to be the biggest for the industry since the crisis. We are live on the Facebook page of fintechalliance.ph, and I believe we're also in watch parties of different FB pages of digital companies and simulcast in various social media platforms. You can also catch a recording of this virtual event in Signal's One News and This News TV over PTV4. I am really hopeful that with this new show of force, a quick V-shaped recovery is likely. Do join the conversation by sending in your thoughts and questions in the comment section. We also have social media questions for you to ponder on and respond to. Without further ado, let me introduce our keynote speaker. Prior to his appointment as BSP Governor, he served as Budget Secretary from 2016 to 2019. His third time to head the Department of Budget and Management, or DBM. His policy expertise and research contribution extend to various areas of public economics, such as the structure and scope of government, tax policies and reforms, public expenditure management analysis, fiscal decentralization, national budget, and public debt, among other topics. Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome the Monetary Board Chairman and the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas Governor, Dr. Benjamin E. Diokno.
All right. Thank you, Fintech Alliance.ph, for inviting me to give the keynote speech in this virtual forum on the fintech's role in pump priming the economy. I would say that this topic is not just timely, but also inevitable as we transition to a new economy thrusted upon us by the COVID-19 crisis. Renowned for their agility, adaptability, and digital fluency, fintechs are uniquely positioned to support the country's bid to shape a new economy that is more resilient, inclusive, and technology-enabled. The pandemic has been widely described as unprecedented. Others have likened it to a war, decimating the economy and the society in its wake. And these are not exaggerated portrayals. The Development Budget Coordination Committee is projecting a worst-case scenario of -3.4% GDP growth, the deepest contraction since 1985. Unemployment rate, from its historic low of 5.3%, is feared to go double-digit with the looming economic slowdown. The unprecedented crisis calls for unprecedented response. And with the likelihoods and lives of millions at stake, the national government and the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas acted swiftly and boldly. Fortunately, we entered the crisis with solid macroeconomic fundamentals, which afforded us sufficient fiscal and monetary policy space to do so. The BSP immediately undertook a series of monetary policy and financial sector regulatory adjustments to mitigate the economic impact on people and firms. By March 19, just days into Luzon's enhanced community quarantine, the BSP has already made a year-to-date cumulative 125 basis points policy cut rate. And this was shortly followed by a 200 basis points cut in the reserve requirement ratio. We complemented these monetary policy adjustments with other liquidity enhancing measures, including the temporary suspension of term deposit facility auctions, the reduction in reverse repurchase volume, and purchases of government securities in the secondary market. To support the government's health and fiscal program, the BSP purchased 300 billion pesos worth of government bonds under a repurchase agreement with the national government, which can be increased to 500 billion pesos if needed. On top of this, we remitted, or BSP remitted to the national government, 20 billion pesos of advance dividends. An important aspect of BSP's financial sector regulatory intervention are the micro, small, and medium enterprises and the informal sector, which are among the most vulnerable in this pandemic. MSMEs generate 2/3 of our country's employment and represent 99% of the total number of firms. And to stimulate bank lending to the sector, the BSP has included new MSME loans as part of the bank's compliance with the reserve requirements. We also issued temporary reduction in the credit risk weights of current loans to MSMEs, and the assignment of a zero risk weight for MSME exposures that are covered by guarantees from the Philippine Guarantee Corporation, the Agricultural Guarantee Fund Pool, and the Agricultural Credit Policy Council. The BSP likewise lengthened the period of relief on the reporting of past due and non-performing loans of borrowers affected by the COVID-19 to December 31, 2021, from the original timeline of March 8, 2021. These measures are designed to free up bank resources to expand their MSME loan portfolio. Meanwhile, the national government, under the Bayanihan to Heal as One Act, launched key programs to support the adverse impact of the pandemic on the MSMEs and the informal sector. These include the 205 billion social amelioration program covering informal sector workers, the 51 billion wage subsidies for employees of small businesses, a 1.2 billion peso guarantee fund for MSME loans under field guarantee and soft loan program for MSMEs under the DTI and ACPC. All these measures supported the country's survival and containment response geared to keep the economy afloat amid the crisis. So the first round of immediate response was primarily about winning the war. That was Act One. Now, with the government now preparing to lift movement restrictions, we are moving into Act Two, where we are called to rebuild for the post-COVID world. The pandemic has revealed and brought urgency to necessary reforms around public health, social safety nets, disaster response, and countryside development. But what reinforces all these reforms is the digital imperative. There's no arguing that the new economy is digital. Our aspirations for a more inclusive and prosperous post-COVID world necessitate putting in place the critical pillars of a digital economy, including robust digital infrastructure, digital skills, e-government, digital ID, and an enabling legal and regulatory framework. All this have given new urgency to BSP's long-standing financial inclusion and digital transformation agenda for the financial sector. The BSP is committed to achieve, by the end of my term, at least 50% of retail payment transactions shifted to digital, and 70% of adult Filipinos having and using a transaction account. Towards this end, the BSP has drawn up a 3-year digital payments transformation roadmap, outlining our priority policy initiatives, including open banking. From where I stand, fintechs as an innovative provider and enabler of digital financial services will find compelling opportunities in this digital transformation agenda. Now is a good time to act. Congress has moved to file proposals for structural reforms and massive economic stimulus package targeting MSMEs, among others. Government agencies and banks need digital solutions to efficiently deploy funds to target recipients of this billion peso support measures and loan programs. Fintechs can be and can provide the needed solution. For instance, fintechs can offer turnkey loan origination and underwriting platform for the government's direct lending programs. Another could be digital solutions for MSMEs pivoting to e-commerce. Some fintechs can serve as digital payment channels, while others can offer last-mile lending conduits like cooperatives and microfinance institutions as shared digital platform to better serve and reach more clients. These are just some of the fintech solutions for the post-COVID measures that come to mind. And I'm sure there are many others that the FinTech Alliance members can offer. There's no playbook for how FinTech can pump prime the economy, but we can perhaps be guided by basic principles for success. To me, that would be seeking strategic partnerships, innovating solutions for impact, and never losing sight of our mission. Rahm Emanuel, the former mayor of Chicago and chief of staff of President Obama, has famously said that we should never let a serious crisis go to waste. This is a useful reminder for this pandemic, which has made digital transformation a clear and urgent national agenda. I wish it were under better circumstances that I will say this, but the fintech community has a lot to look forward to, and even more, to contribute in the shaping of the new economy, one defined by shared and sustainable prosperity. With our collective efforts, may we be able to look back at this crisis with no regrets for wasted opportunities. May you have a fruitful and insightful discussion ahead. Maraming salamat at mabuhay tayong lahat.
Maraming salamat po, BSP Governor Benjamin Diokno. With Governor Diokno's presentation as jumping off point, let's find out how we are going to bounce forward in a global pandemic. We will have three sets of discussions this afternoon with the country's industry leaders and stakeholders. Now, since we want this digital forum to be as interactive as possible, we want to get as well our viewers' pulse. If you are following us on Facebook, we invite you to participate and answer our social media questions. Our first social media question is being flashed on our screens right now. And so again, if you're following us on Facebook, do leave your comments below and your questions as well, and we'll try to get to those. Our first question for this afternoon is, which program do you think will be helpful for MSMEs during the post-COVID-19 recovery? A, payment deferments, government, banks, and utilities, tax discounts or credits, C, low interest loans from government banks, and D, others. Now, let's go to our first panel discussion. Our first group of panelists, we are joined by the Managing Director of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas Center for Learning and Inclusion Advocacy, Ms. Pia Roman-Tayag. Also joining us will be FinTech Alliance Chairman, Mr. Lito Villanueva. Let's start with Ms. Roman-Tayag. Pia, your thoughts.
Thank you, Robbie. On that question, I will say all of the above. You know, the extraordinary circumstances this pandemic has brought about to businesses in different industries has been significant, and there needs to be multiple initiatives to address not only the relief during this time of the pandemic, but really bouncing forward. And our governor has laid out very clearly what the BSP has done swiftly and decisively in the wake of this pandemic. And we will really continue to work with the industry to make sure that we sustain, that we are able to sustain the efforts that have begun since this pandemic started. So all of the above would be my easy answer, Robbie.
Sige, okay. Let's jump to Lito. I suspect if these are going to be short interventions, we can use a lot of our time, therefore, to have a discussion. But Lito, quickly, your thoughts.
Well, number one, thank you to Governor Diokno for gracing this digital forum for the fintech industry. And I think he's practically right in terms of really encouraging the fintech players in terms of continually innovating and practically providing the framework for all these fintech players to thrive, especially in this current crisis. We've seen how the digital adoption of consumers would have been in terms of, you know, because everybody was caught off guard, no, in terms of this pandemic. And I think I would like to comment on what the governor said, no, on how the fintech players would now be able to be to serve as conduits or as loan originators for the government's push to support the MSMEs. I think this is really part and parcel of the government's trust in crafting the recovery framework for the country. And I think those three or four items that he enumerated would really be critical in ensuring the active participation of the fintech industry. When you say fintech, this would really be all-encompassing. I mean, this would really provide cover all those digital players, regardless of industries. And in fact, we've seen the exponential growth of most of the players in the industry during the crisis, because we've seen that, I think, even the, you know, the target of the governor in having 50% of the transaction financial transactions in the country moving to digital by end of his term at 50% would, I think, be surpassed. Well, thanks to this pandemic, but no thanks, but still, I think this is really, you know, as I've said, I mean, this pandemic really disrupted all industries, all sectors. I mean, including how Filipinos are now accepting or embracing digitalization.
Okay, thank you, Lito. Now, Pia, let's go back quickly to your point. All of the above, and certainly the guide question that we started with, it does come from a particular insight. Government surveys do already show the top of mind for MSMEs are payment deferment to government, banks, utilities, tax discounts or credits, low interest loans from government. So all of the above naman talaga yung concerns ng lahat. Could we just prompt you for details on the programs of government and the BSP for any of the key items here?
Yes. First of all, no, the importance of MSME is just really highlighted during this pandemic because they are most vulnerable. Yet, as the governor pointed out, they are really the backbone of this economy in terms of employment generated. So when an MSME has difficulty, the multiplier of that for the employee is really very significant. And so I think we are all seeing the importance of initiatives that will continue to support MSMEs. So the first one is really the relief in terms of tax incentives, in terms of loan relief. And the Bayanihan Act has spelled that out for us with a mandatory 30-day grace period for all types of loans. And this includes business loans to MSMEs. And this really envisions an opportunity to lessen the burden for these MSMEs to think about loan payments during this time. However, that's the relief portion, no? But really to be sustainable and to rebuild after this pandemic, what we will need is support financially, technical expertise, linkages to markets, enabling platforms that will help them adjust to this new digital economy are really crucial. And here, the governor also mentioned the initiatives of the BSP in terms of lowering the policy rates, in allowing MSME loans to be considered as part of the required reserves that we expect from the banks. And basically, this just translates to us making sure that the funds to MSMEs will continue to flow. We are incentivizing banks to continue to lend to MSMEs, especially after this pandemic, because they will be the ones who will need this assistance to be able to continue their business and really support the millions that they are employing. So aside from the BSP work, government has also put in place other measures. Like, for example, there is a rehabilitation financing facility under the SB Corporation for those micro enterprises and small enterprises that have been affected. The guarantee fund, again, to encourage more lending to this sector. and hopefully more support to also the microfinance industry, because they are the ones supporting really our smallest entrepreneurs who are really helping the local community. So the answer is really, it has to be all of the above. And one thing the fintechs could play a role in is really on preparing these MSMEs for the new economy, the new normal, the digital economy, whatever you will call it. I think we already know how it will look like. And yeah, enable platforms for SMEs to reach larger markets, to ensure efficiency in the delivery of their services, to make sure their facilities where their data, their transaction data, their sales data could be used for their advantage, maybe to access more loans, maybe to have more streamlined delivery of products. These are all opportunities where fintechs could enable and support MSMEs to prepare for this new economy.
I'm sure MSMEs are hearing this. These are all very nice to hear, but this is of course on one side of the equation, but everybody's concerned about cash flow. But if over the next 2 to 3 years, many businesses start, as we anticipate, everybody, not just many, will be asking for payment extensions, that would mean liquidity concerns, not just for the MSMEs, but even for highly leveraged banks. What will be the BSP's direction here? What will be the incentives, and in which particular areas? I mean, and how far will that go? Will it go as far as, when you talk about interventions, will it go as far as considering bailouts? Are we pushing people towards mergers and acquisitions and so on?
I have to reiterate what the governor said. We came into this pandemic in a position of strength, and our banking sector is one of those industries. No, our capital adequacy ratio before the pandemic, as of end 2019, stood at about 15% or 16% on consolidated basis, and this is way above what is required regulatory requirement and also even international standard setting bodies. And so this gives our banks some leg room, if you will, when faced with this pandemic. Aside from that, the non-performing loans of our banks stood at just at 2.2% as of February 2020. And we have been conducting stress tests to see the effect of possible defaults on loan payments and the effect on the balance sheet of banks. Of course, there will be an effect, but as I said, it really helps that we are facing this pandemic in a position of strength. In terms of mergers and acquisitions, I mean, even before this COVID pandemic, the Bangko Sentral has always been promoting, strong, stable institutions. And so if this will be through mergers and acquisitions, this we put in place the regulatory framework to encourage this, to make sure that the financial system, the bank serving our customers, are strong and stable.
Okay, both to Pia and to Lito. Quickly muna lang to Pia. The governor, and you also mentioned the lending package, no? 200 billion peso lending package for those who wish to avail of reducing risk. Field guarantee can be used as collateral. Quick question, does this apply as well, and can this be used by other fintech players as well? Can other fintech players be conduits for these funds for which you can use field guarantee as well?
Yes, definitely. Field guarantee is for loans to MSMEs. So it can go both ways. The fintechs themselves could be MSMEs, or the fintechs that are participating or undertaking some lending operations could also be conduits. But of course, what was mentioned in terms of lower risk weighting for loans that are guaranteed by field guarantee, those will apply to the banks that we supervise.
I think add to that, Robbie, no, to what Pia said, I think this is also a good opportunity for, while the fiscal and monetary incentives or interventions provided by BSP would really apply to mostly for banks or BSP supervised financial institutions, I think this is also an opportunity for fintech players to partner with various banks who would now be would serve as conduits in relending those loans. So banks being the wholesalers and the fintech players being the retail lenders directly to their immediate subscribers or customers.
Okay. I mean, speaking of incentivizing those groups, Ms. Roman-Tayag, I remember, I think it was in the Business World Economic Forum, when you said that when it comes to digital disruption and fintech, the BSP's role is really to create a sandbox here, setting the parameters on the one hand, at the same time, allowing for the tools, if not the toys, to allow people to innovate in a safe and still innovative environment. I'm just curious, over the past 3 months, in these abnormal times, because you shared that in certainly not only normal, but really rosy times. But in the past 3 months, in these abnormal times, was there any insight as to what that sandbox should look like moving forward? Are there new components, new parameters, new toys, new innovations that should be included in that sandbox that we now realized over the past 3 months?
First of all, Robbie, thank you for remembering what I said. I don't know how long ago that has been. But I think, you know, the stance of the BSP in encouraging innovation, in understanding it before regulating it, which allows space for this kind of flexibility, is consistent. And it's a principle that we think, that we think is sustained. And I think what this pandemic showed us is just how important and how accelerated the pace must be for these kinds of innovations. To give you an example, you know, in our sandbox, there are experiments or there are some test and learn initiatives on agents, different types of rolling out cash agents. And now with the social amelioration program, for example, we are seeing if only that has been already fully rolled out, that could have really eased in terms of disbursement of funds to many of our beneficiaries who would have already had accounts when this pandemic happened. So I think the difference would be just a better understanding among players of the importance and the urgency of these initiatives that make use of the regulations that are in place and also capitalizing on, you know, the innovative thinking of our fintechs, both banks and non-banks, to really deliver those financial services to those who need them. So really, I think the pace and acceleration is what this pandemic has shown us.
Lito, private sector perspective on that same question. And what have you realized over the past 3 months should be, if not necessarily created and incorporated and added, maybe just strengthened? And what are some key insights that were really heightened over the past 3 months?
Well, I think number one is really the true bayanihan spirit, no, between the private and the government sectors. I mean, the private sector quickly delivered in terms of responding to the crisis, to the needs of the crisis, no, in terms of helping the government, in terms of really looking into their immediate, care, who are the employees of these companies, and practically going beyond the call of duty in terms of also providing support for the other less fortunate individuals or the vulnerable sector. So I think we have seen the tremendous support from various industries as well. You know, may it be from conglomerates, from mid-sized companies, and even from MSMEs. We've seen the massive support to government in terms of providing those services. No, I think that's why the development of a digital economy is really something of value for everyone, because I think, again, we're all in this together. Thank you, Robbie.
Yeah, Lito and P, I remember this meme that was going around my lumabas social media call, and the graphic said, so what finally pushed your organization into digital disruption? A, your CEO, your CTO, your CIO, or was it COVID? And the reality is that a lot of people got pushed into the deep end. Suddenly, we're all paying our people digitally. Suddenly, we're transferring cash digitally. People are now aware not just of banks, but even of the pawn shops where you can remit, all the different centers, all the different apps. But Lito, what were the perspectives? And on the one hand, I'm sure you're saying tumaas, di ba? People now using the digital economy. But what were the insights in terms of existing barriers pa rin? What are still the barriers? And also on the regulatory side and on the things you will need, what were the insights in terms of, for example, KYC, know your client protocols and so on, and insights when it comes to the national ID system? In other words, the things that will enable more of this behavior, what have you observed both on the good side as well as remaining barriers?
I think the biggest barrier still would be the national ID system. Well, good thing that the president made mention this last night, that he is really pushing hard for the implementation of or execution of the national ID system. And he said that he will make it a reality starting this October. So I think we've seen that particular huge gap when we saw the slow disbursement of the social amelioration program. I mean, that has been a nightmare for the SWD to be really looking for practically providing those cash or assistance to all these 18 million families. So it took a while for them to really, have a 97% completion rate on the first tranche of the social amelioration fund. And I think once we have the national ID system in place, I don't think it would be a problem anymore. And disbursing it would be in a matter of seconds or minutes, because again, I think that is the trust of even the NEDA acting secretary Chua, secretary Dominguez, and even Governor Diokno and the rest of the government officials, and of course with the support of the private sector.
Maybe Robbie, on that question, I think the policies and regulations as well as the solutions and products were there pre-COVID or were ready to be deployed. And as I said, it was accelerated because of this. No? What I would comment on as a barrier would really be more on the behavioral aspect, which is typically hard to move. You know, sometimes even if it makes sense to go digital, people will still want to do cash or would want to do the manual. So I think the behavioral push, I think the COVID pushed that a little bit, but there is still some challenges in terms of awareness, understanding, and trust. And while we have the products and the channels available, while the regulations now allow for remote onboarding, remote transactions, it's really the understanding and the trust that is a barrier. And here, we really need to rely on all partners to increase the literacy, for one, to make sure that their systems, when they roll out something, are safe and secure. And BSP is also, apart from our regulations, coordinating with the industry, because we cannot go digital without people really trusting the system. And I think that is one barrier that we still need to address collectively.
Lito, we're almost out of time, but I thought it might actually be a good fundamental question to ask you. What's the FinTech Alliance? We talk about the financials, we talk about the tech. People then, therefore, I certainly get this impression, this is an aggregation of banks, maybe some software and computer and IT companies. But what's the FinTech Alliance? Just so we can have an appreciation of when people are trying to figure out FinTech interventions, what exactly are we talking about? And how much of a multi-sectoral concern is this?
Okay. Well, the good thing there is that the coalition or the collaboration across all fintech players in the industry would really show the solidarity of of this particular sector. And what we've seen so far is that fact that most of these fintech players have been actually tapped by government in disbursing those funds. So, for example, you've seen PayMaya or GCash or other bank providers as well. For example, in our case, RCBC. We were able to provide support to government in disbursing those funds. And I think we have seen, again, the exponential growth in terms of adoption. And part of the thrust of FinTech Alliance really is on how to ensure that we will be able to help regulators, particularly BSP, SEC, NPC, and the Insurance Commission, to be able to provide that two things, no, two-pronged approach. One is on financial education, and the other one is on digital literacy. Because financial education is not just the be-all and end-all of things in terms of having to have an inclusive society, but there must always be the digital literacy as well. Because as what was mentioned by Pia a while ago, trust is really something that would be primary in the minds of the public in terms of them really trusting, you know, a mobile device for their financial transactions. Because for most of them, mobile device would only be limited to social media, to calling and texting, etc. But beyond that, they don't even know that, you know, mobile phones or mobile devices would be a tool for your business, for your financial transactions. So I think that's why the FinTech Alliance is giving so much premium on these two areas, specifically on financial education and on digital literacy. So that's the thrust of the Alliance in terms of pushing for a cash-light digital economy.
Okay, let me just read a couple of comments before we thank our first panelist. This is Jen Valdez saying, on the demand side, there should be liberalization or relaxation on the documentary requirements. Initial loan amounts can be tiered while building credit history. JRM Lano also says, there are a lot of innovative Filipino startups, specifically fintechs. The challenge is lack of access to decently priced and patient capital. With this crisis, hopefully, capital could be directed towards innovation. And again, just to prompt, if you're following us on Facebook, do leave your comments and questions. We can't cover everything, unfortunately. We will be relaying this to our speakers and hopefully have the conversation continue that way. We're about to wrap up the panel. Just a final thoughts, Pia and Lito?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you, FinTech, for inviting me to join this panel. I think more than ever, we really need this collaborative effort to really not bounce back, but bounce forward. And I think the learnings from COVID have strengthened what we have all really embraced, that collaboration, FinTech, banks, whether banks or non-banks, have an important role to play in really providing financial services to sectors that need them the most. And that is what this pandemic has highlighted. And the Bangko Sentral will continue to make sure that the regulatory framework is one that will facilitate and encourage innovation and new ideas. And we will really also work with you in the other aspects of our work, such as Lito mentioned, digital literacy, financial education, and in really ensuring trust and certainty in this new economy. Thank you again, Robbie and Lito, and we'll be happy to answer the other questions, I think, later on.
Later, yeah. Thank you, Pia. And of course, we will be looking forward to the next set of discussions. No? So we have two more sets of discussions coming your way. And of course, thank you, Pia. And of course, thank you to Governor Diokno. And we'll see you in a while. Thank you, Robbie.
Okay, maraming salamat. That was Lito Villanueva. You'll still see him, I suspect, later on in this program. Siya ang punong abala natin. Actually, thank you again, Lito, for having all of us. And that was Ms. Pia Roman-Tayag of the Bangko Sentral. Now, we'll move on to the next panel. But before we get there, again, we would like to invite everyone to participate and answer another social media question. Our second question is being flashed now on your screens. Share with us your answers in the comments below. Now, this is the question. One of the structural reforms eyed by government is that every Filipino family must at least have one bank account. How feasible, how realistic is this, especially in the short term? A, do you think it's very feasible? B, slightly feasible? C, uncertain. D, impossible. And while we're waiting for all of you to mull that question and jump in the comment section below, we'd like to start calling in our second set of discussants. It would be interesting to get more insights, again, taking off from this question as well of including more people in this initiative. Joining us this afternoon for our second panel are the Card MRI founder and chairman emeritus, Dr. Aristotle Alip, the president of PayMaya, Mr. Shailesh Baidwan, and or SB for short, and the president of the Management Association of the Philippines, Attorney Francis Lim. I'd like to invite first off Card MRI founder and chairman emeritus, Dr. Aristotle Alip. Dr. Alip?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Robbie. Thank you very much, Lito. First, I'd like to really thank Governor Diokno and also Pia for articulating the very important the importance of microfinance institution within this COVID pandemic. It's really heartwarming to know that there are a lot of initiatives or incentives being given to MSME, and the very important role recognized for microfinance, as noted by Governor Diokno, that this is the last mile for the lending conduits, because actually the frontliner, we're able to provide the vulnerable and unbankable all these financial assistance and requirements to help the small businesses and micro entrepreneurs to really start or restart their own business. I fully agree that every family should have every family should really have one bank account. In fact, within the context of card, we're even encouraging not only the husband and wife, the children, but even the school children to start having this bank account so that they can start on savings. So this is really a very important reform. And through this digital transformation, I think this is happening now within the context of card. You see, we have around 7 million clients include in the microfinance circle. So I think this is something that we are really encouraging. And this is really very good, especially in this, what is happening now in this COVID-19 pandemic.
Okay, let's bring in SB, Mr. Shailesh Baidwan of PayMaya.
Thank you, Robbie. So first of all, I would also like to thank the Governor and FinTech Alliance for organizing this forum. Indeed, I think Pia made a number of important points. So I think first of all, the fintechs, I think we carry a massive social responsibility as we are potentially the first point of contact and the first point of entry for a lot of people into the financial system. As regards the question of bank accounts, I think what is uncontested is the fact that financial inclusion is absolutely the need of the hour, and we need to accelerate that. Now, if we were to kind of just step back and look at you know, while not all of them, but a segment of the population did receive their social amelioration disbursements from the government in their wallets, whether it was GCash or with PayMaya and some of the others. What we are seeing is that is kind of, in some ways, a de facto account for them. They are able to use the money in that account, whether it is to send money to other people, whether it is to pay their bills, whether it is to buy airtime load, or whether if they need to cash it out. So to some extent, the role that we are playing in this situation is pretty much of providing a tool for people to be able to do financial transactions, in particular during this period. I think the other key component over here, which I think is important, I think Pia touched upon it. The reality is that as fintech players, we would love to see everything go digital, but there are a number of areas where unfortunately cash is still right now the only way to transact. So the ability to move from online to offline and offline to online is what we are seeing is extremely critical during this period. So digital is not the only be-all and all solution. And to give an example over there, our Asian network, the Smart Padla network of about 30,000 sari-sari stores through which we provide that, has been a key component of bringing together the wallet aspect of it with the physical aspect. Now what's happening is that from these people are getting money in the wallets, and if they want to take the money out, they're going to these Smart Padla locations, which are spread through the length and breadth of the country, and frankly have been pretty much the only opportunity for people to get and access and take out cash. These are also serving today for people who don't have their own wallet, for example, to go in and pay the electricity bills or other bills, to buy airtime load, and to send money. So there's an interesting play of online and offline, which is coming to the fore. So while digital will pay, and it's absolutely the need of the hour, but the interspersing of digital and the offline piece is equally critical, as we are discovering, especially during this period.
Okay, and before we jump into our discussion, we'd like to hear the thoughts of the Management Association of the Philippines President, Attorney Francis Lim.
Hello, thank you very much for inviting MAP to this forum. Well, if there's one lesson, or among the lessons learned from the COVID pandemic, is the importance of digital readiness. Just imagine how we can work or conduct meetings from home during the lockdown without a reliable internet. Technologies like Zoom, FaceTime, Skype, MS Teams, StreamYard would be useless. Just imagine how we could be paying our bills during the lockdown without fintech. In the ASEAN region, I think the Philippines was an early comer in e-commerce or digital economy. As early as 2000, I think June 14, 2000, then President Erap, Estrada, signed into law Republic Act 8792, otherwise known as the E-Commerce Act, which laid down the legal framework for the digital economy. Under said law, an electronic document was made the functional equivalent of a paper-based document, and an e-signature was made the functional equivalent of a handwritten document. What does that mean in layman's terms? Whatever a paper-based document was doing could be done by an electronic document, and whatever a handwriting signature can do could be done by e-signature. Compare this to, let's say, Thailand and Vietnam. I think they had their e-commerce act, the equivalent of our ECA, only in 2008. No? And the CA, mind you, mandated that the whole government should go digital within 2 years from its effectivity. Subsequently, Congress enacted other laws supporting the digital information transformation. Examples, we all know, are the Cybercrime Protection Act and even the Data Privacy Act. Likewise, there were several roadmaps that have been put in place towards digital transformation. For example, the Philippine Strategic Roadmap for Information and Communication Technology Sector, 2006-2010. I think that was the timeline of the roadmap. The Philippine Digital Strategy Initiative covering the period 2011-2016. But almost 20 years after the E-Commerce Act, the vision of government going digital remains to be seen. I've been working in terms of trying to put in place rules on e-commerce. And I recall that way back in 2004, we submitted rules on e-notarization, where you can notarize documents, and a Philippine-based notary can get the notarization of documents from persons living in Hong Kong, the other signatory living in Davao, the other signatory living in the United States. That could have made our business very easy. Unfortunately, because we don't have the digital infrastructure, the rules have not yet been approved by the Supreme Court. In fact, I was talking last night to one justice of the Supreme Court, and I told him, you know, Justice, we need the authorization nowadays because we are on a lockdown. You cannot physically go to a notary public and have your signature acknowledged. Yes, he said, but the problem is we don't have the infrastructure that supports it. So I think that is very important in terms of moving forward our digital transformation, getting our digital infrastructure ready. So what's the result? I think there's this study called e-commerce provision by Google and the other fintechs, and it forecasted the country to be the smallest digital economy come 2025. On the other hand, Indonesia, which was a latecomer, will end 2025 with 133 billion digital economy. Thailand is projected to be $50 billion, followed by Vietnam, which is a latecomer in the ASEAN world with 43 billion digital economy. So that just goes to show that even if we're first, or among the first in digital transformation, we are still lagging behind. That's the sad story of the Philippines. But having said that, I think all is not lost. There are pieces of good news. The same report, the special report says that the Philippine digital economy is expected to grow to reach $25 billion in 2025. In fact, it states that of the six Southeast Asian countries, the Philippines has the most room for growth. Okay. Currently, I think the internet economy makes 2.1% of the country's GDP and is expected to hit 5.3% by 2025, and that's 5 years down the line. And it's a big jump. Okay. Now, in 2015, as everybody knows, the DICT law was passed, creating the DICT as the central body in charge of planning and implementing a national ICT development agenda for the country. Last year, I think some of us already know this, the DICT came up with the National ICT Ecosystem Framework, or NICTEF, in an effort to have a roadmap for the country. So, and we're glad that government agencies like BSP are into the picture. We heard Governor Diokno saying that the BSP has put in place a 3-year digital payment transformation roadmap. In other words, government agencies are getting their act together in order to realize this digital transformation. Another piece of good news that I'd like to share is that I'm closely working on the stimulus bill assisting Congress. And there is a provision in the proposed PESA law, the Philippine Economic Stimulus Act, which grants a subsidy or incentives for digital transformation of businesses. So it just goes to show that digital transformation is foremost in the minds even of our legislators. In short, in order to realize that the vision of a digital economy, we should have a whole of country approach to it, because as Governor Diokno and Pia have emphasized, there's no arguing that the new economy is digital. No, to paraphrase former President Bill Clinton, it's the digital economy is stupid. So that's my take on this digital transformation. Thank you.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Attorney Lim. Let me bring back SB and Dr. Alip. I want to take off on your point about inclusivity. Lito has always emphasized, there's fintech alliance. We talk about the financial. We talk about tech, but alliance is really about the people. And it's in a panel especially that emphasizes the importance of inclusivity. I'd like to take off on your point about the non-tech barriers to including people and the barriers that people do have. SP, first off, to your point, just to prod you a little more on your reflection and your insights. People have a problem with a bank account. You tell them, open a bank account, and they say, oh, that's not for me. I don't have enough savings. That's only for people who actually have savings. But you talk to them about a pocket, or you talk to them about a wallet. Oh, I can relate to that. What are your insights with regards to addressing these barriers, which is not even technological? It's almost as if it's learned behavior, that certain tools are for other people and certain tools are not for me.
That's a pretty big question and a very interesting question, Robbie. I'm not sure I can do full justice, but let me give you my insights. I think there are a couple of factors at play over here. First of all, we have to recognize that Philippines is amongst the youngest countries in the region, if not in the world. So it's got a very, very young population. The second is that I think if you look at the usage of social media, it is amongst the highest consumption of social media pretty much anywhere in the world. So you've got now a mix of a young population who is very comfortable with digital channel and social media. And hence, I think their worldview and perspective of using tools that play in that space is very, very much more comfortable than potentially other areas. So as a starting point, I think if you approach them with something that they can relate to, which is something that works on the mobile, something that is easy and intuitive to use, something that's simple, I think that works better. Now, the regulators and the government actually have provided a very strong infrastructure and set of regulations that is helping today fintech. So for a wallet, for example, you can do a digital KYC. You can pretty much, you know, download the app, record a liveliness video of yourself, take a photograph of a valid ID, upload it, and at the back, we bash together the whole use AI ML, and we can approve you instantly if you're a legitimate person. Now, that, I think, works with the way they are used to interacting otherwise. So the financial services also have to interact with them the way they are used to interacting with other facets of life. I think the banks are also beginning to recognize that, realize that, and are beginning to do that across the world, including, I think, in the Philippines, some of the banks and the solutions that are coming out with. I think this has to be a concerted effort across all the players, because the penetration and the need for financial inclusion is so large. We're talking about, at best, 20% of the population really being served. There's 80% which is excluded. So I think it has to be worked across, but the recognition has to be that you have to play in the sandbox of how the customers are used to playing versus trying to play in the sandbox that you are used to playing.
Okay. Mr. Alip and Mr. Lim, let me prompt you with a point sent in by one of our viewers. Christoph De Leon points out a very basic thing. One barrier to the digital economy is basically connection. Of course, SB touched on this as well, that it's not all about digitalization, because a lot of people are still offline, if not in areas hard to connect. But at the same time, as you said, penetration of social media is very, very high. So where are we exactly in your assessment with regards to connection?
Robbie, let me respond to that in this way. First, for this financial inclusion, the Bangko Sentral has a very, very good policy, the Circular 1022, that allows KYC using ID and also the technology. So you don't have to go to the client don't have to go to bank. You can use technology for the KYC. So that's very good. So this will, in a way, move faster involvement of the unbanked. The second one is the Circular 940, wherein the banks are now authorized to do electronic banking solution, so they can implement cash agent. Now, I'd like to deal more on this financial inclusion thing. It is very right and very correct that the connectivity is still a concern. It's a big issue, but in as far as card is concerned, we're doing every possible way by connecting to different kinds of providers and also different kind of technologies. And we're able to do this already. In fact, we have about 3.6 million clients already that have been registered to our system through this kind of using the digital transformation. But Robbie, there's also one thing I'd like to articulate. I think it is important also for microfinance institutions like the banks to be given also tax credit, as has been mentioned as one of the incentives, because realizing that microfinance institution is the last one can do it, I think it's important for us to be given also that tax credit, because we're the difficult part. And if we can do this by performance, it will, if we're able to reach the hard to reach areas through this kind of fintech technology, digital, I think this will be a very good incentive for us, because you know it's very expensive to go to these different areas, the island towns and hard to reach communities. You know? And there are so many, because we are 7,100 islands, and there are so many indigenous people that we're trying to reach. And this will also help us create more incentive. We have this tax credit. I'd like to also point out, when you talk about financial inclusion, one thing you're mentioning about this connectivity and also using the digital transformation. Yes, we're doing this. Microfinance institution, microbank, card bank is also on the thick of this. But the main concern now for the institution and microfinance institution to really move forward, as mentioned earlier, I think we need liquidity. You cannot have digital transformation if you don't have enough liquidity. In the economic stimulus fund or bill that's being discussed in the Congress, While it is very heartwarming to note that MSME is one of the key pillars in within which the government will, there is nothing mentioned or articulation on the role of microfinance institution on this MSME, because if we are treated as the frontliner delivering this last mile, I think it's important to articulate that, because when you talk with Land Bank, they said that they can only give to us liquidity. Of course, they don't have problems giving liquidity to SB Corporation, but we will need concessional loan. If that is not articulated in terms of the funding, then we cannot get a 0% interest rate for microfinance institution.
And okay, Mr. Al, okay. Yes, go ahead. You can finish your sentence lang po. I just need to jump in because we're about to run out of time and I need to wrap up this panel. But please wrap up your thoughts.
Yeah, so these are very important. These tax and also the Microfinance Act should not be repealed anymore, because this will, the Microfinance Act allows NGO to only pay 2% of the tax. So this is very important for us to really move forward. In fact, government should further strengthen that. The other one is microinsurance. The Mutual Benefit Association is also now using this digital transformation, this fintech. But I think government should be able to articulate that this should be also not be taxed, because the MBAs or Mutual Benefit Association is an insurance community run by the community members themselves. Thank you very much, everybody.
Okay, unfortunately, that's all the time we have for this panel, and we have one more to call in. Again, we'd like to thank Card MRI founder and chairman emeritus, Dr. Aristotle Alip, the president of PayMaya, Mr. Shailesh Baidwan, SB, thank you, and the president of the Management Association of the Philippines, Attorney Francis Lim. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you.
Now, while we're getting ready for our next and final set of discussants, again, we would like to know what you're thinking. If you're following us on Facebook, you're seeing the comments section below, please join us in this conversation. We can't get to everything, particularly as we mentioned everything, but it's a fascinating discussion going on over there as well. So follow that. And here's another question for you to get involved in. We would like to know your thoughts. The question is being flashed on your screen, our final question. And the statement is, I believe that the economy will be able to recover in the pattern of A, we are anticipating a V-shaped, very sharp recovery after this very sharp decline. B, L-shaped recovery, a slow recovery after the decline. C, a W-shaped recovery, another decline following another recovery. And then D, others. So again, if you're joining us via Facebook, do mail that question over, and we would love to have your thoughts and to have this conversation going with your insights as well. While you're considering joining that discussion, we would like to call in our final panel for this afternoon. Joining us are the chairman of the Institute of Corporate Directors, Mr. Francis Estrada, the Senior Vice President and Head of Consumer Wireless Business at Smart, Ms. Jane Basas, and GCash, Head of Data Analytics and Financial Services, Mr. JF Darre. Let me start off, I welcome again to our panelists. Let me start off in that order of introduction, just inviting your initial thoughts on what we've been discussing so far. Mr. Francis Estrada of the Institute of Corporate Directors, sir.
Thank you very much, Robbie. I've enjoyed listening to the final discussion so far. And thank you for inviting the Institute of Corporate Directors. To the specific question that you asked, my answer would have to be both a forecast and a hope. Is really not a V-shaped. I don't think I'm that optimistic, but not. And I hope that it is a U-shaped recovery. Probably a less rapid recovery, but one that would be more stable and would be less vulnerable to a second collapse, a second cycle, and a recovery after that, or a W. Why do I say this? I say this for a number of reasons. As you know, among the things that COVID-19 has done, the amount of destruction it has wrought on aggregate demand has been phenomenal. And you know, like much like the United States, the model that we have in many respects followed, 70% of our economy is consumption. When you couple that with the loss, the general unemployment rate, the unemployment, the employment that has been lost, the vulnerability of the MSME sector, you've looked at the overseas remittances as well that are a very large component of domestic demand as well. And we've seen, we've watched the news on overseas workers, our seamen, and so forth. We have to be, I think, realistic and really expect that it is going to take a little bit of time to recover from that. And hopefully we don't recover to where we used to be, but rather that we learn some of the fundamental lessons that this whole exercise has shown. And let me, if I may, dwell into some on some of those lessons. I think it is one of the things that we have been rudely awakened to is the reality. In the past, it was all rhetoric, but the reality of our interdependence. You cannot have, and this walks, segues into the issue of inclusion. You cannot possibly have or sustain rapid growth in aggregate terms and yet have such a distorted distributive structure, which is to say that have a, such a large pool of highly vulnerable people that are poor. That is about a reality is quite clear. Now, the Institute of Corporate Directors, its principal advocacy is about best practices in governance and long-term stability. And there, and the best practices in governments, the thinking on enterprise has changed very drastically. As you know, the old paradigm had to do with the maximization. The perception was enterprise exists precisely for the maximization of shareholder profit. That over the last 10 years has shifted to a point, and these are values that are now subscribed by the largest global institutional investors, as well as the OECD, World Bank, etc., which really says you can't limit the maximization process to simply shareholder interest. There are too many lives involved. And therefore, the paradigm is now shifted to a position where you are looking at maximizing long-term stakeholder interests, which is to say that includes your obviously your shareholders, majority and minority, your customers, your suppliers, your distributors, your employees, and the entire value chain and the markets where you operate. So I think that is fundamental in our discussion. Within the context of fintech and the digitalization of the economy, I think this has obviously enormous significance. I think Dr. Alip has mentioned, for example, the last mile role. You know, in their particular case, they have north of 7 million customers from north to south in the Philippines. Those are very, very, and those are the most, in many, many respects, the most vulnerable. So my thinking is that we have to think smart. Now, the good news, my final point is, the good news is you have had an unprecedented complementarity in the responses of the fiscal and monetary sector. And in the Philippines, that has been particularly visible. You've seen basically all stops pulled. But what this means, though, is that you're going to have to make sure that those very large numbers, much as we have the fiscal space to borrow and fund, we have to make sure that we do not come into a reversal. My fear of the W growth or the L-shaped recovery is really that you are going to be seeing a huge risk from a governance point of view of these resources not going and not being used where they are supposed to be and not arriving at a more sustainable model. I'll give you my other comments and questions a little later. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Estrada. Now, Ms. Jane Basas of Smart.
Hello, Robbie. Allow me to first thank Lito Villanueva for inviting me over in this session. So I guess to answer your question, Robbie, allow me to answer it from the point of view of us in the telco industry. Assuming we don't go into a second or a third wave of infections and lockdowns, we're actually quite optimistic about the state of our industry. We believe that fintech and the load business, which fuels the telco industry, will follow a V-shaped growth pattern. Because at the end of the day, this new normal will require access to digital solutions and digital platforms. Mm. And that's the core of our business. To be quite honest, in the early stage of this ECQ or lockdown, we saw our business going down as a huge portion of our retailers, the sari-sari stores, suddenly had problems accessing our products, no? And our distributors couldn't even access them because a huge portion of our retailers are actually still not digitalized. So we are focusing our efforts in making sure that supply chain is addressed. It's been recovering in the past several days. We've seen some great recoveries in the first few days of May. In fact, the volumes that we are seeing is already close to pre-COVID times. And we think this is because, you know, people are actually pivoting from using legacy services like call and text. More and more people are buying data solutions, and not just, you know, entry-level data solutions. They're actually buying more expensive data solutions, longer validity data solutions. And when you have access to data, you know, everything else in the digital ecosystem will follow, right? That includes consumption of entertainment, of payments, of e-commerce, etc. So we're quite bullish that at least there are opportunities that we're seeing amidst this pandemic.
Okay. Mr. JF Darre of GCash.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Robbie, and thank you, FinTech Alliance, for having me this afternoon. Good afternoon also to Governor Diokno and our fellow panelists and our audience. So today I actually learned a lot from our discussion. A very interesting conversation. I heard a lot of very powerful opinions. And again, reflecting on that and preparing for the recovery, I believe in particular that telco and e-wallets can play a major role in enabling that recovery. I heard about a lot of very good initiatives from the government, like helping banks lending, guaranteeing funds, subsidies, right? And of course, all the donations that are going to be redistributed to the nation, the SAP program, all of these great, great, great programs and initiatives, we can be part of the solution of basically distributing and being the last kind of mile person. Like we've illustrated a little bit recently, we've done a partnership with Makati, right? And Makatizen, and we're helping Makati disbursing almost half a million people, 5,000 peso to each, right? And we're also working with the DSWD and many other organizations. So we hope, you know, that we can play our role in the recovery. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, JF, Jane, and Mr. Estrada. Now, let's get into a discussion. We don't have a lot of time. We'll try to get as much as we can into this. But specifically to JF and Jane, I'd like to have to this give some continuity to the previous panel. When we were talking about connectivity, we were talking about barriers, not just technological barriers, but even cultural, even behavioral barriers to people opening accounts and making this pivot, this leap, however you want to characterize it. But I actually go all the way back to our keynote speaker. BSP Governor Benjamin Diokno said he is committed to achieve by the end of his term, that's 2022, at least 50% of retail payment transactions shifted to digital and 70% of adult Filipinos having used a transaction account. From what you've seen over the past 3 months, how realistic is that? And what are the caveats as well as the hopeful signs that you're seeing?
May I answer that first? Mm-hmm. Yeah, Robbie, in the ecosystem of smart, around 70% of our subscribers are already equipped with digital devices, right? So we are left with 30% who are actually still on feature phones, right? And of those 70%, roughly around 40% are actually already transacting digitally. And this this situation that has pushed us to actually look at multiple digital solutions will actually accelerate the process of digital adoption of the remaining 60-50% who are not still transacting via digital platforms. So one of the things that we actually did during COVID was to propagate our app, our digital app, which forces our sari-sari stores to engage with us via digital solutions. What's difficult with our business kasi, Robbie, is while the product is virtual, the collection is actually still manual, largely manual. So we're going to push our ecosystem to make sure that that entire distribution system and that entire process is achieved via the digital solutions. So how reasonable that target is, that three-year roadmap towards digitalizing 70% of sari-sari stores, I think it's quite reasonable for as long as all the shareholders and stakeholders work together.
Okay. JF, yep. What are you seeing from your analytics?
Yes, yes. So actually, we see, of course, a drop in transaction volumes offline, obviously, because of the ECQ, but we see a healthy kind of a recovery already over the past month, of especially on transactions that are flowing through our pipes, right, through GCash. Also, I'd like to mention that one initiative that we've had recently is that every Globe and TM users can use GCash even without load, right? So we zero-rated the data consumption of the app so that you don't even need to have a load. So as long as you have signaled, you can use GCash. So that's, for example, a good initiative to remove, you know, some barriers of access. So again, what we do see though is a surge in online transactions. Our online transactions already constitute the majority of our transactions on GCash. Offline is actually not yet very big, but not only that, on online already multiples of the offline has already probably up 250% over the past 2 months. Right, and that's talking about Google, Apple, right, and of course Lazada, Shopee, etc. So we're already kind of seeing that transformation accelerated, definitely, even in the very short term, even in the 6 weeks.
Yeah. Okay, quick question to the two of you, and then I'd like to bring. I have a question for Mr. Estrada, but very quickly, how's the infrastructure? I mean, I imagine this was quite a surge on the infrastructure side. I mean, how did that? How are you coping on that side, both for Smart and the Globe?
Nako, Robbie, this tested our network, right? Obviously, this usage was we didn't anticipate this. Imagine from the Smart side alone, in the month of April, we saw 100% surge in our data traffic, right? And I think overall in the PLDT group, around the 25% surge. But I guess I'm happy to say that the network is holding quite well. And I think this is because for the past 2 to 3 years, we've had significant investments in our fiber infrastructure. We've invested so much money in our data infrastructure. We've invested money in our LTE rollout. You know, if this COVID didn't happen, our ambition was to actually upgrade all our base stations into LTE base stations by the end of the first quarter. But obviously, there will be delays in that. So those investments have paid off. There are some areas that are still quite challenging because we didn't design our network to actually support usage from the homes, right? The network was designed primarily to support the central business districts, the urban areas, but people, because of COVID, have actually moved towards the suburb and the provincial areas. So we look at our network and our metrics every day, and we adjust. We've done refarming so many times to make sure that the data demand is addressed.
Yeah, that reminds me of an insight that I heard from an Asia Society Philippines forum. McKinsey said one of their insights was that there was a surge, obviously. I mean, some of the industries that were resilient, if not registered, actually some spikes was things to do with food, things to do with groceries, medicals and drugs, of course, but also in-house entertainment.
Yes.
And all of that riding on your infrastructure. JF, very quickly, and then I'll bring in Mr. Estrada. Very quickly, JF, what did you see on your infrastructure?
Actually, very, very similar. Very similar dynamic. Same idea. Actually, very in parallel. Globe has invested a tremendous amount of money in building up their network and infrastructure, particularly in the past over the past 5 years. And I guess you know the network was prepared and kind of to get the surge. But a very good point raised earlier that the network was more. You know, triggered to empower business and where business activity was happening. And that's been a challenge. But so far, I believe that, you know, we were able to deliver also our services and continue almost with little disruption businesses that could work from home.
Okay. Now, as I said, I want to bring in Mr. Estrada because Jane mentioned ecosystems. Mr. Estrada, I want to ask about ecosystems on two levels. One is the overall, the macro ecosystem for this digital fintech environment. What are the weak points that you think is worth highlighting? Where are the gaps? Where are the weak points in that ecosystem? And then the ecosystem within organizations. What are we learning about organizations and how they're structured, both from executive to management to our teams? What's lacking in our organizations that has really become quite evident over the past 3 months?
Okay, first, in terms of the overall ecosystem, I think we're all committed. I think the Governor Diokno spoke of the digital imperative. But we've got to put some substance in terms of the strategy that is going to be employed to achieve that, which is to say, if I go back to infrastructure, for example, you've both spoken of surges and so forth, but the issue really is, if we're serious, and thank goodness, this is one of the blessings that COVID-19 inadvertently brought. It had accelerated to a very large degree the process of digitalization. But if we're serious, we should set very specific objectives that are benchmarked against the right standards. In other words, what is our connectivity relative to our peers in ASEAN? What will it take to make that happen? And I think that has to do with a question of both incentives and penalties, if you will. In other words, if we set a specific set of targets, as in all strategies that are quantifiable, there should be, and the players should be given the incentives for achieving those benchmarks. On the other hand, if you do not achieve that, then again, there should be disincentives. I also believe that, for example, CAPEX, to the extent that CAPEX is a very important component of the decision-making of the carriers and the infrastructure providers, then I think there should be, other than just tax incentives, there very well might be other incentives. You could, for example, say, in much the same way that MSMEs are given a much lower risk rating in determining bank portfolios, you could very well make the same kind of proposition for CAPEX that is intended to really essentially increase bandwidth. Hmm. The second thing, on a more corporate side of things, I think you should begin where we have to begin are really in the boards of directors of enterprises. And in the sense that the reality is, as a general rule, there is a lack of knowledge, a fear, a lack of familiarity, and an alien character to all of this. And it is terribly important that our enterprises begin to understand at the policy and strategy level all of these implications. And to do that, you must have directors that are knowledgeable, that understand the limitations, and also understand the risks of not leading into the digitalization path. There are some serious downsides if you don't do that, and you simply have got to be ready. And that begins, in my opinion, from the top. Thank you.
Okay, some questions from our from our viewers. But if you don't mind, I'd like to bring in Lito Villanueva before we get towards the end of this program. But if we could bring in Lito.
Sure.
Hi.
Yeah. Hello. Lito, let me just invite you again to jump in on that question. What are some existing gaps that the FinTech Alliance and you, given your hat at RCBC, that you're identifying and would like to highlight?
Well, I think what is really critical is that, for example, for FinTech Alliance, so we were able to quickly, mobilize ourselves in terms of helping, the government and also coming up with various digital fora such as this, to gather all experts and to gather industry, practitioners to come up with, solutions or with insights on how to better help government in really addressing the issue of the pandemic. And of course, we just received, the news about, DOH Secretary Duque saying that we are now experiencing a second wave of COVID-19. So that is just about a few days after we were declared under MECQ. So, I think really the virus is really the enemy here. And the thing is, how can, all the industries, the sectors be able to really address this issue? And I think the only way by which we can be able to have that sigh of relief is the moment that this vaccine has been developed and the entire 7.5 billion people on Earth will have been vaccinated. So I think, again, no amount of effort, could be minimized or could be downgraded in terms of the impact of the contribution of each member of the society. And I would like to also highlight the fact that, say, for example, our co-ops, our microfinance institutions, our rural banks, and other lending companies who are part and parcel of the MSME sector, they are really at the forefront. I mean, they are even frontliners in terms of serving our Filipinos in the countryside. So I think that's why, the alliance is it's a very comprehensive coalition of all of this industry, these companies or these institutions that are really geared towards pushing for inclusive digital finance.
Okay, final question, like to Jane and JF, and then I'll ask Lito to help to lead us into concluding our program. But Jane and JF, as you know, DICT Undersecretary Eliseo Rio has been quite vocal and then quite excited with the prospect of the National Broadband Program, and he was also very quick to try to reassure the private sector that this is not out to compete. If anything, we think that this will enable competition among in more competition, especially in serving the last mile. I just bring that up by way of framing a larger question of how does the private sector and the government sustain the cooperation that has been engendered by this crisis, and what do you see moving forward in terms of this continuing relationship with government and the private sector, and the insights about the different areas that impact not just on economic recovery but national development.
Robbie, us in PLDT and Smart, we're very, very committed to helping our customers, to helping the communities, and to helping the government, right? It's almost a daily exercise talking to many government institutions. Like, we talk to DOH on a daily basis, or the Department of Education, trying to figure out how we can resolve the challenges that will be brought about by study from home, the reality of study from home, and the fact that a huge portion of our society still don't have access to basic internet solutions. We can we've done as much as we can. We've provided and subsidized smartphones. We provide subsidized pocket Wi-Fis. We've actually given free loads to a lot of the student scholars. But you know, at the end of the day, the responsibility of getting the economy back on track is with the government, right? But we will commit to working with them as much as we can to make sure that, you know, as a responsible corporate citizen, we can give back to society as well. But the task is daunting, Robbie. Imagine, I'm a mother, right? And there are 32 million students that are going back to school by August 24. And if you think about the statistics, there are roughly around 3 to 4 million homes that have access to the internet, and probably around 3 to 5 million have access to pocket Wi-Fis, right? What happens to the remaining 80% of students who don't have access to good enough internet to be able to study well from the comforts of their home? So there's a lot of conversation that needs to be done. One company cannot solve it. 10 companies cannot solve it, right? We have to work together and innovate together to be able to help the country move forward after this.
Yeah. JF, your thoughts?
Yeah, actually, that's a perfect segue to what I was going to say is, as much as possible, what we're trying to build at GCash, and we often like to call ourselves actually a tech fin, you know, you mentioned about fintech, but because we like to think of ourselves of a technology company that will enable financial services. That's how we like to think about it. And for instance, as was mentioned a little bit earlier, I think that was the second poll question, right? When we asked, like, how realistic do we think it would be to open, you know, bank accounts to all households in the Philippines. And honestly, the only barrier right now that I can think of is really a national ID. After that, the e-wallets in particular, GCash as well, obviously, we enabled eKYC, that was mentioned a little bit earlier by SD. Mm. 5 minutes, right? You submit your ID, you have the facial recognition, it really takes 5 minutes. And then we have a partnership with banks. Again, because I want to repeat, we want to be a platform, not a bank. So we want to work with banks, right, to create a platform where they can deliver their services to our users, right? And so we've opened, for example, GSafe last year, and we already opened 2 million bank accounts, right, 40% of which were their first bank accounts. And that was possible and done all completely 100% digitally, right, and very conveniently as well, as I may add, right, only 5 minutes to open a bank account. So really, again, that's, I guess, how we want to play our role, you know, like enabling the nation, truthful to even the Ayala Group initiative, who has been consistently also committed to a nation building, right, initiative. And we each want to build, basically, be a strong kind of a component in these private and public, public and private partnerships to help both, you know, our less fortunate Filipino citizens, as well as the MSMEs, obviously, right, through access to funds, loans, and allowances, et cetera. And I hope, you know, we continue on the track that we've seen over the past 2 months. The growth that the e-wallets have seen over the past 2 months is very promising in that a symptom, if I may say, that the country and the nation is digitalizing.
Okay, Mr. Jeff Darre of GCash, Jane Basas of Smart, and Mr. Francis Estrada, Chairman of the ICD. Maraming salamat po for joining us. And I'd like to call back Lito Villanueva.
Thank you. Thank you, Robbie. And thank you to Jane, JF, and Francis Estrada of ICD. Mm. Yes, and of course, we would like to thank all our discussants, our panelists, and of course to our BSP Governor Diokno for gracing this event. And we, you know, and of course we were thank you to all our FinTech Alliance members who've actually also provided the facility for their watch parties. And we actually have more than 15,000 viewers across all social media platforms. And also, may I also invite everyone for the you know, for the second annual FinTech Summit that is called Beyond FinTech. So this will be held on October 20 this year. And thank you again, Robbie, for all of this, you know, for the time that you spent with us. And of course, this will also be shown on Signal TV and also on PTV4 later this week. Yeah. Thank you.
Maraming salamat din, Lito. It was an honor to be here. Thank you to FinTech Alliance, and thank you to everyone who participated in social media and the public discussions and who joined our conversations online. Again, we would like to thank our keynote speaker, Governor Benjamin Diokno of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas, and this afternoon's discussants, Ms. Pia Roman-Tayag, Mr. Lito Villanueva, Dr. Aristotle Alip, Mr. Shailesh Baidwan, Attorney Francis Lim, Mr. Francis Estrada, Ms. Jane Basas, and Mr. JF Darre. This has been the FinTech Alliance PH We Bounce Forward Digital Forum on Pump Priming a Digital Economy Post-COVID-19. Please, everybody, stay safe. Thank you for joining us on Facebook Live and on Signal TV's One News. It was a privilege. Robbie Alampay of One News po. Keep safe and have a great day, everyone.
Thank you to our host, Mr. Robbie Alampay, and to all participants of the FinTechAlliance.ph's We Bounce Forward Digital Forum on Pump Priming a Digital Economy Post-COVID-19. Stay safe and healthy. Don't forget to join us again at the second FinTech Alliance Summit that will be held on October 20, 2020, digitally. Visit the FinTechAlliance.ph Facebook page or website for more details.